Hello, everyone, and welcome to Friends of the Force, a Star Wars podcast. I'm your host, Brad.
And I'm your host, Sarah.
And this week on the show, we are talking about Star Wars The Bad Batch, episode number 11, titled Devil's Deal.
Dun dun dun.
I know, scary. It is directed by Steward Lee and written by Tamara Becher-Wilkinson. So this is going to be a full spoiler discussion. If you haven't watched the episode, please go do so before you listen to this. If you saw Star Wars' social media post this morning at 9 a.m., you probably had the episode spoiled for you. Because that was a shocker. They just went full-blown spoilers in their preview. But although there wasn't really much in this episode that you couldn't not spoil because it was the whole episode. But I woke up and we watched some good Ryloth, Syndulla family, Star Wars politic action.
Yes, and then you proceeded to send me approximately, in your words, approximately 30 messages.
I was very excited.
And then in the Discord, we're like, I just sent Sarah approximately 30 messages. Wake up, Sarah.
Yeah, I totally outed you to all of our Discord members.
You did, as me not being awake. But I woke up, I read all of your very excited, very hype messages, and I was like, rad, this is a lot, but okay. And then I watched the episode and was also like, this is lovely. This is a good time. So I can understand all your hype, exciting messages. And I appreciate your enthusiasm all of the time.
Yeah. I love this episode. It is definitely a top episode for me this season. Obviously, the big, big moment is Harris and Dula and Chopper. They're the focus of the episode. This is the point of view that we're getting for Devil's Deal. The Syndulla family in general and the Imperial presence on Ryloth, which we've seen Ryloth so many times during the Clone Wars and even during Rebels, I believe. Cham Syndulla has popped up in a lot of different places, both in publishing and in those two shows as well. So it was really wonderful to see him back in the mix and also to see Hera's mom. I don't think we've seen Hera's mom before, ever. I might be mistaken, but I love a good mom. She was giving me some pretty heavy Vanessa Doza vibes. I just love a good mother and daughter relationship because I've been begging for more of those in Star Wars. So even if we only get it for a couple episodes, I'm pretty happy about it. But Sarah, what did you think of this episode and also just the scope of it and the fact that we only saw the Bad Batch for about 3 minutes out of a 25-minute episode? It was quite different.
Yeah. So I'll say firstly that I really enjoyed the parallels between the beginning of this episode and the beginning of the Raxus episode last episode. I appreciated how we've kind of gotten these different points of view with regards to the galaxy's actions. So we got it in this episode, in the previous episode, and then in episodes, I believe, 2 and 3 on Onderon, right? And the planet where Sue and Cut are, which I can't think of right now, where they're kind of reacting differently in these different situations with the Empire. So we're kind of getting that again in this episode, and I really enjoyed the different point of view on the in the different place and how they're reacting. So I enjoyed the galactic scale of this story. I also found it really exciting that we were back with characters that we did know, like obviously people like Hera's amazing.
She's so good.
She's so great. So I was just thrilled to see Hera and Chopper. And I think this a lot of this episode was set up. So I'll be really looking forward to how the next episode pays off everything that was set up in this episode.
Yeah.
So I'm really excited for the potential of it.
Yeah.
As much as I enjoyed it, like I think the next one is going to top it.
I do see this more as a setup, like you said. And when you look at this episode and the next one, which the title has been leaked, it's called Rescue on Ryloth.
Mm-hmm.
When you look at those two in tandem with each other, I think they're going to make for a really great, like, 1-2 punch.
Yeah.
Like, 100%. Kind of like a 40-minute event, you know, like involving Hera, involving that character that we know and love from every medium at this point, almost. So it was so great to see her back. Like, when we first saw Cham and her mother, Eleni, I think is how you pronounce it. And when it cuts over to like that Imperial facility and you just see Chopper's thing go up behind the rock, like the little like camera look around thing that R2 has on Dagobah. And I'm just like, oh my God, it's Chopper. And I just like immediately started laughing hysterically and crying. Like I was just so happy. And then to see him come up and just go, whoop, whoop, whoop. And I'm just like, oh my God, Star Wars is good. Like I just love this. I love it so much. Like, what was your first reaction when you saw Chop and Hera just like on that hillside?
Well, I knew it was coming at that point because, yeah, you know, the internet, but it was really nice. It was really nice to see them. And I didn't expect to get Chopper. Like, I just expected to see Hera. So getting Chopper as well was just an absolute delight, because who doesn't love the womp, 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 womp,
yeah,
womp, you know, like of Chopper. He's so great and brings back all those good Rebels vibes, right?
Yeah. Voiced by Dave Filoni as well. Again,
you mean Chopper himself.
Chopper himself, yeah.
So like, it was really nice to have them back. And I do think that this next episode will take more from the Batch's point of view, I think. I think it'll split the point of view more evenly. And I think that'll be really curious. But again, that's speculation. But I was very excited. I was refreshed to see an episode from a completely separate point of view.
Yeah, let's talk about the point of view of this episode for a little bit and why that specific choice was made to, again, only have the Bad Batch be in 3 minutes of this episode. And I will say it's not entirely unprecedented in Star Wars animation. I know a lot of episodes in the Clone Wars have had episodes that, you know, don't center on our main protagonists. I think of that droids episode, for example, like when they're all stuck in the bleak white void or whatever on that one planet, and they find like a clone commander. I'm kind of blanking on all the details right now, but it's the droid arc. It's George Lucas's favorite arc, but it doesn't feature any Jedi or anybody that we really, you know, kind of know. But the series is not necessarily doing that too early. I think it's sometimes good to have things from other perspectives, especially when a lot of the show has been kind of trying to both give us all of the growth and perspective of the Bad Batch while also exploring this time period that we haven't seen before. Mm-hmm. Because we've never really seen the post Order 66 aftermath and like the immediate aftermath at that. So to then also see it through a character that we already know definitely adds a layer there. And mm-hmm. I think that's just one part of it. But like when we look at the show as a whole, we're asking, what is the question and how is this going to lend itself to the Bad Batch themselves? They're trying to ask themselves, who are we if not soldiers? And how do we fit in this new galaxy? Well, then the next question is, what does this new galaxy look like? And I think having Ryloth and having the perspective of people who fought so hard during the Clone Wars to then see where they are under the Imperial Fist adds a layer to that galaxy and to like what it looks like and to how people are experiencing it, similar to what we've seen in previous episodes. I think it's only like one episode out of the 16 that we're really not going to see much of the Bad Batch, which I think is a pretty good rate. And I think having just one episode where they're not really involved is not necessarily a bad thing. I think mm-hmm. it just kind of fleshes out this time period even more. And I'm personally a fan of that. I think it adds a lot to it.
Yeah. And I think that they're definitely seizing on an opportunity where, you know, they decide they're going to Ryloth and they say, oh, well, we've got characters that we know and have used before and that the fans really love. So why not center this one around them? Which allows us to understand that question of what does the galaxy look like? How are individuals reacting to and resisting in that galaxy, in this new world? And how does the Bad Batch interact with them? And we saw that the Bad Batch interacted with them through a job with Cid to provide weapons to Gobi. So we are kind of understanding that they're not there of their own volition at this point. They're still there on mission from Cid. And, you know, it makes me wonder if this is a turning point for them in some way, like a true turning point where they make a decision one way or another to either fight for better or fight for worse. And I think it was really interesting that we got them in this capacity, because when we see the mission from their point of view, we're kind of seeing something of the same. They're getting taught some different lessons, they're going on these adventures, but it wasn't about them this time around. It was about the individuals on the planet, like explicitly. So I'll be curious if Hera is instrumental in them kind of making the decision to actively be better and not to just survive and you know, get money on the jobs from Sid. And if so, that makes me makes my heart warm, because that Omega Hera moment was very soft.
Yeah, and how much more rewarding would it be if, when we see the Bad Batch change for the better and like maybe follow a cause like Rex was kind of pushing them to do, as opposed to chasing credits? Mm-hmm. It's so much more rewarding when it's like, oh, Hera is the one who did that, because we all love Hera. Everybody's a fan of Hera, and she's popped Hera's up in so many places, right? And so then add that part of her history to say like, oh, like she went on a rescue mission with the Bad Batch to bust her parents out of jail, out of Empire jail on Ryloth.
Yeah,
like that's pretty cool. And yeah, it is a nod to those fans, but I think also giving her this entire episode of backstory helps other fans maybe potentially get introduced to Hera that might not have watched Rebels.
Mm-hmm.
So overall, I really like the style. And like, even the last episode when we started with that Senator, Avi Singh, and it was like that for 5 minutes or so, we just saw from his perspective, you mentioned the parallel. I kind of like that. I kind of like seeing the sort of situation first, then let's jump over to the Bad Batch. This episode felt like a longer version of the cold open from last week. That was only like, you know, the first 5 minutes.
Yeah, which really makes me excited for next week's episode, because I feel like it's doing so much of the work, expanding that 5 minute cold open from last episode into the 23 minutes of this episode, giving us high stakes for the next episode for both people who haven't maybe, you know, seen Rebels or know of the story of Ryloth, and for fans who have seen and know the story quite well, knowing that we're about to, you know, come to a kind of, if I may, a nexus point.
It's a Loki reference.
Yeah. A kind of important moment for the people of Ryloth. It heightens the stakes a little bit. It makes it all the pieces fit in more interesting, you know, patterns. So, I mean, I'm just really looking forward to knowing where it's going.
Yeah.
And there's a line from Cham, and he says, you know, to Hera, like, I hope you will never have to live a life like mine. And I'm just like,
and she does the rest of her life.
Like,
pretty much.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Rebels. And then in the Alphabet Squadron trilogy, and you're just like,
yeah.
Ooh.
Which, you know, she thinks a lot in the Alphabet Squadron trilogy about, I want to settle down. I have a son. Like, I want to be a mom. Victor's Prize. I don't want to be a fighter anymore. You know, I've been doing this my whole life, and we've seen her here now literally doing this since she was a kid, like running spy missions with Chopper and accidentally attending an arms deal with the Bad Batch, you know? So it's interesting.
Well,
yeah.
Gobi kind of pushed her into that.
Yeah. Yeah.
But yeah.
But I, you know, I think it is a little too early though for people to like criticize this and say like, oh, it, you know, it doesn't add anything to the Bad Batch. It's only one episode out of 16.
Yeah.
I mean, I think of a show like Doctor Who, for instance, the episode Blink, which for any Doctor Who fans out there, if you've seen Blink, the whole idea is it's like a whole, it kind of just like drops you in with these random characters, one of which is played by Carrie Mulligan, which like crazy
to think back
to her playing in that episode. But that whole episode is like, who are these people? We don't know who they are. Like, where's the doctor and where's the companion? You know, I'm sure people probably had the same reactions. Like, this is a bad Doctor Who episode. Where's the doctor? You know, but there's that twist at the end. And we find out like
angels.
Yeah. We find out the doctor is like trapped in time basically by the weeping angels. And that episode ends up becoming, you know, despite being referred to as Dr. Light, it's one of the most critically acclaimed episodes of the series that like people say is like a top five episode. So I just think it's a little too early to say like, oh, this doesn't add anything to the Bad Batch. We have to see how it all solidifies with our part one and with our part two next week. And there might even be a part three. We don't know how long this arc's going to go for. This could go for four parts. We just don't know.
Yeah, we've got Rescue on Moryloth next week, then Infested, then Warmantle. And then TBA and TBA. Infested.
Whoa, sounds scary.
I got when I say the word, I have to kind of put some emphasis. Infested.
That makes me think of Halo 3 for some reason.
Oh my god, I was just about to say that.
And you have to say it in the Halo announcer voice. Infested.
Infected.
Infected. Triple kill. Anyways, so I think of those like spore things in Halo 3, you know, when you got that one mission and you're like, you know, any Halo fans listening, you know. But anyways,
I'm so glad our brains like both went there like in that split second. We were both like, we're playing like zombies on or whatever.
Is Master Chief gonna show up in the Bad Batch? People are gonna be really upset about that. But yeah, I think it's just a little too early to call. We just gotta see how this all rounds out by the end, because I think, you know, 40 minutes combined, that could be some really, really good life-changing stuff for the Bad Batch, and to see it come through Hera's eyes again, especially with that moment with Omega that we'll talk about, would be really cool.
Can we just like jump into that moment with Omega?
Yeah, let's do
it. Just talk about it, because it was my favorite part of the episode by far. Like, it was so perfect and so special, and I absolutely lived for it. And this moment is like Hera being really excited about the ship, Omega inviting her on and showing her around. And like, it was so soft. It was so good, because we know Hera isn't a pilot yet, but we know she's going to be one of the greatest pilots that, you know, the Rebellion has ever seen. And here's Omega kind of living her dream in some ways, who is not a pilot herself yet. But it's these two young women just sharing in this experience and kind of bringing their excitement together. And it's Omega reciting the specs and saying, you know, tech won't let me fly the ship until I can name everything, which was such a great moment. But then Hera just being like, flying is about a feeling. It's, you know, the instruments help you, they guide you along, but it's about a feeling that you have.
Mm-hmm.
And then Omega goes to the Bad Batch, goes, did you know flying is about a feeling? And they're like,
Tech's like, what?
Yeah, like, what I love about that is that, you know, it clearly shows that like the Bad Batch has I don't want to say like a rigid way of life or anything like that, but they have very set parameters in their life,
set modes of thinking.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
You know, they're clones. They've been programmed to fight in this war. And they've got these particular traits that define them in a large way because of their quote unquote defects, right? And I don't think they've ever allowed themselves to consider the feelings in it all. And now Hera is like, it's not about, you know, where the throttle is and where the defector shield is and like all these pieces. It's about, you know, putting yourself in the seat and doing it. And I just really appreciated that Omega hearing that different point of view. And also, you know, Omega showing Hera like what life is like for her in the briefest of moments. I just thought it was so special.
Well, she's been getting all the different great things about being a free kid, right?
Yes.
Not being confined to the walls of Kamino. I mean, the second episode of the series, we just saw her come out the ship and start kicking dirt.
And yes.
Play, you know, playing fetch with the kids. I would say that's like the last time she really had one of the kind of biggest kid bonding moments, was like them playing fetch in the yard. And also the Zygerian pirates, she kind of said goodbye to that one girl that was that they save. But here it's like that kind of classic, you know, you make your first friend at school and then you invite them over and you're like, oh, this is my house. Like, let me show you like my room. And like, oh, let's go to my basement. I'm going to show you like our playroom and stuff. And you get like so excited because it's your first time having a friend over and you're just like so excited to show them everything.
You're like, I have to tell you about my entire life so you can be my best friend and know everything.
Yes, exactly. So this is what that felt like. It was like, oh, let me show you my room. Like, when we're not being chased, it's a turret, you know? Yeah. But otherwise, that's where I live and that's where I sleep and that's cool, you know? And that's just so funny. She's like, it's my room.
I have to say that, like, I quite literally did this a couple weeks ago. I met up with a friend who I hadn't seen in the longest time, my very best, you know, friend from high school. And I have redecorated my room in the time since. And I was like, I have to show you my new room. So, like,
we still do it.
12-year-old Omega. Or whoever old she is.
It's just so great. But that's like really her first time to say, hey, this is something that's my space.
Yeah. Let me show you who I am.
Yeah.
Through my space.
Yeah. Like I have a place that can call home. Let me show you it.
Yeah.
And that's just really cool. It's just people talk about how this lacked character growth for the Bad Batch. That was a hell of a lot of character growth for Omega in a couple of minutes, in my opinion. I think that was pretty good stuff. She's going to remember that probably the rest of her life in some ways. Like, flying is a feeling. Did you guys know that? I mean, that right there alone is so cool for her to learn something from somebody else that is not the Bad Batch. That sticks with her.
And it really expands her point of view.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the Bad Batch is teaching her in their very masculine perspective, because again, like, she's got four dads, but for like another young girl to come and tell her something and to teach her something, I think is really special and a really great role model and peer for her alongside her four dads.
Does this pass the Bechdel test?
Does it? Well, it's like two women not talking about a man, but don't you need like three named women? Oh, I mean, I guess we have three named women in the episode.
So the Bechdel test is whether a work features at least two women who talk to each other about something other than a man. The requirement that the two women must be named is sometimes added.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
So this would pass the Bechdel test.
So they're named.
Yeah.
They're both girls. They're talking about ships. And then we've got the mom as well. And then the other lady who also talks in the towards the end in the fight.
Yeah, it's just great to have them be in there and talking about their interests rather than like, oh, let me tell you about the Bad Batch, or like, oh, let me tell you about my dad Cham, you know, like to talk about other men around them. Like, no, let's just have like a girl-to-girl conversation and like, let me show you my room, let me show you around the ship, like we're having like a play date basically. And it's a great friend moment,
as Saoirse Ronan in Little Women would say. Women. Thank you. That's
great
all.
Movie. Everybody should watch Little Women. It's a great film.
Yep. I don't know where to go from there. I've talked about my favorite moment. It's all downhill from here. I'm kidding. It's still a great episode. Where do you want to hop to next?
Well, let's keep talking about Hera, because she's just exciting the hell out of me right now. Sure. This is her version of A New Hope, essentially.
Oh.
You know, that shot of her looking at the sky and you see her hand come across the frame. That's like a beautiful. One of the most beautiful shots I've seen in Star Wars animation.
The music?
Her theme coming back, so good.
I was like, oh God, this is so beautiful. It hurts. Like, so precious and gorgeous. And then immediately the stormtroopers come in and you're just like, ouch, no. No, let her have this moment of peace.
It sounds a bit like Leia's theme, too.
It does.
You know, a little bit of the Alderaan kind of you know?
It's played on the horn. That's why.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if Hera's theme is typically played on the horn, but because it's played on a French horn, I think that's what's. I think the French horn is what.
Yeah, maybe. Music people are not better than us.
Guys, I'm a choir person and not a band person, so I'm so sorry to all of our band listeners and orchestra listeners out there, hearing me butcher instruments. But I know what the euphonium is. Okay. Euphonium is a great instrument. Thank you for coming to my TED talk.
I do love her having that yearning throughout the episode to be a pilot and to get off this rock and to have her own ship. And I just think it adds a lot to her character as well. And yeah, like you said, we did get this episode partially because it is Hera and we get to explore Hera in this time period. Likewise, we got to explore Kanan as well in the first episode, right? I saw somebody tweet like, oh, Hunter's a matchmaker and he doesn't even know it. Like, he's met both Kanan and Hera and they're going to basically date and have a kid. Like, good job, Hunter. You did this. And I was just like, what is going on? What is happening?
That's ridiculous, but also hilarious, because now that you think about it, I forgot about Kanan, but like, I did not put baby them together with big them in Rebels.
That was 11 whole weeks ago, Sarah. That's 11.
I mean, I'm 11 weeks older now, 11 weeks wiser, and I've completely forgot what happened 11 weeks ago. I don't even know what month it was, what day it was.
It was May the 4th. Yeah.
Who would have thunk?
We were sitting around on our phones waiting for Star Wars news that day. Anyways.
Oh.
I have gotten older, but not much wiser. Let's be honest here. Let's clear that up right away. But no, I think it was just really cool to see her origins in a way. And again, I always forget that she owned Chop before Rebels. So seeing him was a surprise. Wah, 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 but wah, they wah. Are like a great duo. Like, name a better duo, please.
I could, but like, I don't want to kill the vibe here.
Yeah. Okay.
No offense, but like Cassian and K2, I just
it's pretty close.
It's a matter of personal opinion, truly.
You know, it's funny. We've always been like, where's the Rebels sequel? but we never asked. What about the Rebels prequel? Folks, we're getting it.
We're getting it, yeah.
Yeah, I think that's kind of cool, though, honestly. I love seeing this all come together, and I'll just never get over Chopper. I'm excited to see Omega interact with Chopper, hopefully, next week. And the fact that, the ending of this episode, just such a cliffhanger. Mm-hmm. The tension, the gunships flying everywhere. The sound of the gunships, by the way, is just so good.
Yes.
Hera fleeing the scene with Chopper, and Chopper's, you know, whisking her away. And I love how her mom's like, Chopper, get her out of here. You know, it just goes to show the kind of bond that Hera and Chopper have, that like he will protect her as well. It's not just a companionship. It's a role of protector. Like he watches over her, mm-hmm. which is really
sometimes
wholesome.
He didn't do a very good job in the very beginning of this episode.
Yeah, not really. But you know, as I think as Hera aged, sometimes it feels like maybe she's watching over him in some ways, because he did a lot of the legwork early on, keeping a watchful eye on her and protecting her. And I think that's just so wholesome. But I love their dynamic. It makes me feel all warm and fuzzy inside. Like they're just like best buds. It's like Christopher Robin and Winnie the Pooh, you know, like it just doesn't get better than that. Honestly, like Star Wars droid person relationship. Ugh, so damn good.
Yeah. Gotta love it. Gotta love it. Even those droids are hecka annoying. Those are my favorites.
Gotta love it.
People
indeed.
Rag on C-3PO, but C-3PO is a precious baby who deserves to be protected. Thank you.
Alrighty, so let's talk about Cham Syndulla for a little bit,
okay?
Because I think the politics of this episode were quite interesting, and I think he's very changed compared to where we see him in the Clone Wars,
which I have not seen.
Right, so I'm going to give a little refresher here for both your sake and the sake of our listeners to kind of explore where he's been. So he's nicknamed the Hammer of Ryloth, which I think is absolute badass name, by the way.
Yeah, it's pretty intense.
He started as a political revolutionary, so he first appeared in the Clone Wars episode Liberty on Ryloth. That was all the way back in 2009, so this is 12 years after we first met him.
He's really old.
Yeah, just kidding. he goes back in the Star Wars canon quite a bit. So he was a political revolutionary who actually opposed Ryloth Senator Orn Free Ta, who's in this episode and gets assassinated. So it adds a little bit.
No wonder Orn Free Ta kind of sucks.
Yeah, like it adds a little bit of tension there at the end when Cham's like, I've sat by and watched your greed and selfishness, like, you know, rise above the needs of Ryloth. Like I've watched it happen, right? Mm-hmm. So he's really there for the Ryloth people, and he forms the Twi'lek Resistance and fights alongside some Jedi and in the clone army. And this is to repel Wat Tambor and the Separatist army. But ultimately, you know, he was kind of reluctant to trust the Republic again and feared their occupation on Ryloth. What's happening now with the Empire? He eventually allied himself with Mace Windu, and they liberated Ryloth together. So it's interesting to see how he was once a political revolutionary, kind of like Saw Gerrera in a way, but for Ryloth.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas Saw Gerrera was for Onderon, and we're seeing a lot of these revolutionaries in the series so far, which is apt for the time period, right?
Yeah, yeah.
It's interesting to see him originally fear occupation by the Republic, and now it's like in the beginning of the episode, he was sort of willingly allowing them to like occupy their planet and say like, "Oh, the clones are gonna protect us. The war is over. So like, let's just have peace and let's just move on." Mm-hmm. Why do you think he's okay with that? Why do you think he wants to just say, let's move on with our lives, let the Republic run things, we're all good here? Do you think it's just that he wants to stop fighting and be a father for once? Do you think he actually believes it? Because it doesn't seem like throughout the episode that he is involved with any of the things that are going on with his brother / Hera's uncle. Whereas for Eleni Syndulla, she's like full-blown, like not trusting the Empire. She's like, what are they up to? Like, why are there military armaments at this base? Like, what's going on? So like, what do you think's going through his mind just from you knowing him now?
I don't think that he's fully on board with the Empire and what they're doing, but I think he's so tired that he's willing to see how things play out in a new system. he's willing to give them the benefit of the doubt, because he says that I should be content that the war is over, but change is not always easy at the very beginning of the episode. So he's clearly unsettled about the whole situation, but he goes with it because he feels that there's a potential for it to actually work out for them. So I see his position as hesitant but accepting, whereas Gobi is much more adamantly against it. He was the one who said the clones are supposed to leave after the war was over. You know, we shouldn't be ruled by troopers. And, you know, he ultimately kind of agrees, but is like, you know, here we are. So I don't know. I don't know. I just feel like he's kind of sitting in the middle. He's kind of just trying to say, maybe we ride this one out.
Yeah, I think tired is the best way to describe him. He is really tired. He tells Hera, fighting takes its toll. And he even tells his brother Gobi, what's the point of fighting if we can't accept peace?
Yeah.
Right? So I think he just wants to lay low for a bit. And it's sort of like a wishful thinking / confirmation bias sort of thing. He wants to see how this could work. He wants to confirm the belief that it could work, that this could last. That, hey, you know, the Empire brought new refineries, it brought a lot of new jobs. Yes, the Empire wants people to step down from their military ranks and their military positions, but like, hey, we got you. Turn over your weapons to us. War protect you. Peace and prosperity. This is what you guys fought for, right? It's somewhat tragic in a way, right? Because he gets into the situation by the end where he's sort of forced to lash out against the senator and making a quote-unquote attempted assassination on him, to where it puts him in the crosshairs of Crosshair, literally, you know, and to say like, oh, look, you just tried to assassinate him. He's dead anyways now. Like, look what you've done. You led to this. Yeah. Now we can arrest you. Even though Chan was truly the one that did want peace, it was his brother who was more of a revolutionary in this case. But this is sort of a catalyst for Chan to realize the Empire is not a lasting thing. It's never going to be. And if you know anything about Chan Syndulla after the events of the Bad Batch, I mean, we know that he forms the Free Ryloth movement, which is to fight back against Imperial occupation. If you want more from Cham, go read Lords of the Sith. Oh. Very big character in that. And he also appears in Rebels for a couple episodes as well. So he's got a long history still fighting the Empire after this. And I think this is that event to prove to him this isn't sustainable. And it was kind of a wake up call to him to say like, I was kind of foolish to think it would be okay. Like, I feared the Republic's occupation once before. Like, why wouldn't I fear it again? It's because I didn't want to see what was there, you know. Mm-hmm. And that's what his brother says. He says, you don't want to see what's there.
Yeah. If I can hop over to Crosshair a little bit, because you did mention Crosshair and the events with Ta, what did you think about that moment where, you know, where Cham is like, this is not how you go. I'm not, this is not how it's happening. And then immediately Crosshair's like, bye, bitch, and kills him anyway. That was like a really shocking moment for me, because I was reading another book. I was reading a book recently. Surprised? You should be.
I'm not.
good. Because if you were surprised, I'd be weirded out, considering I read a lot. But I was reading this book where, you know, character was doing the same thing, where he just got like really mad and at this person who had wronged him years ago, and was like, I'm gonna get you, but it's not gonna be here. And he kind of leaves him. And it kind of comes back to bite him in the butt a little bit, because he let him live, and now they have a mutual grudge instead of a one-sided grudge. But in this one, we did not get to see that grudge continue to play out, because he was immediately offed.
Right.
So I thought this be very shocking. Did you find it to be as shocking, or did you think that was, I don't want to say predictable, but a moment you saw coming that he wasn't going to make it out?
I was shocked, and I actually think this spoke pretty heavily to the conniving nature of Rampart. I thought Rampart was a big player in this episode, more than we've seen him really before. I mean, we've seen him kind of toying with things in the background, but I feel like he was really pulling a lot of strings here.
Mm-hmm.
So he's calculating. He's already one step ahead of everything. It's the reason all those gunships fly in. He's already arresting Cham. Like, he knew where this was all going.
Yeah.
And even earlier in the episode, he was like, I'm pretty surprised that Cham is kind of going into this so willingly, like, against your own words, right? Like, this is actually going pretty smooth.
Both Ta and Rampart are surprised.
Yeah. So I just thought that spoke to Rampart. Did you see that with him throughout the episode? Sort of how he's playing a little bit of puppet master with this planet?
Yeah. Even right at the beginning when he says to Eleni, Oh, unfortunate that your daughter couldn't join us.
That's such a Thrawn thing to say.
It's such a Thrawn thing to say. Yeah. It's such a threat. It's very calculated. It's a very, very pointed question. Not only, and I don't think he would say the same thing to Cham. Like, I think it is a very gendered, pointed moment. Because there's a particular thing you're playing on when you're saying that to a mother.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I can definitely see him, you know, being very calculating. I think my criticism with this episode is that it is, in a sense, a Crosshair episode, because that's the point of view we're getting. We're getting the Empire's point of view. And I wish Crosshair was a bit more prominent in this episode.
Mm-hmm.
I wish we got more of him, because it's clear that he's kind of a leader of this new wave of war mantle troopers of the stormtrooper program, essentially, or specialized troopers. And, you know, we might get more of him, but I feel like he's a bit of a missing link as we've focused on Omega and the Bad Batch over the past couple of episodes.
I'm curious how much we'll get with him in Rescue on Ryloth, especially if the Bad Batch is coming back.
Mm-hmm.
That will be curious. Do you think we're going to get the next episode from the Bad Batch's point of view, or is it still going to be from Hera's point of view, experiencing the Bad Batch coming to rescue her? Like, is she going to reach out to Omega and be like, hey, new bestie.
Hey, bestie. So I need some help. No, I think it's going to split time more evenly between Bad Batch and Hera and her family. So, like, I think it's going to be, you know, doing the work of both of those perspectives. But again, this is just pure speculation. I have no idea.
Yeah, and I wonder, as we get into the final episodes of the season or series, with episodes called War Mantle.
Yeah.
And, you know, are we going to get more? Is it going to turn more towards the perspective of, okay, we got to rescue Crosshair? And maybe this arc is the arc when they finally decide, like, this is the mission now.
I wonder. I definitely feel like that War Mantle episode will be a Crosshair-focused episode. But, I mean, some people's criticism with Resistance is that we didn't get enough Tam in Season 2 as, like, the one who split away.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you could levy perhaps some of that same criticism here.
Absolutely.
So I'm hoping that these last handful of episodes will bring us more of the Empire, the world around Crosshair, and Crosshair's motivations and, like, true desires.
Yeah.
Because I feel like we still need to get that. We've gotten a lot of Hunter, a lot of Wrecker, a lot of Omega, a little bit less about Echo and Tech, but, like, even less of Crosshair. So I want more Crosshair in this whole thing.
That's a really good observation about Resistance, and I hope they can rectify that with the series, because there is a story there to be told, and we do need his perspective, because in my opinion, he still is a member of the Bad Batch.
Yeah.
It's not his fault. It's against his own will.
Does he stick to it? That's the question, right? Like, does he make the choice to be different, or does he say, no, this is who I am now, and I'm accepting this, and I feel like this is the right way to go, you know, when he has the ability to make that decision for himself? Yeah. I don't know,
Sarah. A lot to be seen in these last couple episodes. We have 5 episodes left. 5.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
It is crazy.
We're closing in.
We are. I can't believe we're already kind of here, but we're kind of here. We're getting there.
I really do think these last couple episodes are going to be very Empire galactic stakes focused.
You said when you texted me this morning that it wasn't Panaka. Don't get your hopes up for Panaka. So I was very sad that you had spoiled that it wasn't Panaka for me, but also it wasn't Panaka, so that was a good thing to tell me. But, like, I still am holding out hope that if we're getting Empire-focused stuff, galactic politics-focused stuff, that will get my real prediction, Bail Organa, and my crack prediction, Panaka.
Yeah.
I have to bring it up. It's my thing. It's my my hidden Mickeys. If we get these hidden Mickeys, if they reveal themselves to me, I would cry.
Listen, if this show keeps going and it just kind of turns into the Bad Batch helping out the ordinary people, you know, make a trip to Naboo maybe in season two. Panaka is the rampart there, sort of deal, you know.
Oh boy.
It could happen. Listen, I think this show could go for a while. Let's keep exploring this time period, because I would be kind of bummed if it gets the resistance treatment and like ends after a season or two. Like, this could really go for like a couple seasons, like three seasons at least, if they did it right, if they play their cards right.
If it only gets two, I will have a lot of questions.
Yeah.
Mostly. That'll be my first thing. I just have a lot of questions.
Yeah.
But, you know, that's neither here nor there. We're not quite there yet. But
point being, let's get Panaka eventually. Let's
throw him in there. Going back to finish my circle out here.
Yes.
Another thing I would like to mention, this is just an absolute funny, this is nothing with no bearing on anything else, but there's a moment when Cham is giving his speech that Ta is just gripping like both of his leku with his hands. And I'm just like, that's such a moment when you just start like playing with your hair and you're just like, you know what, I'm just gonna hang on to my hair, you know. He had that moment with his leku, and I thought that was very funny because he was kind of anxious about what Cham was about to say or what Cham was saying.
Yeah,
if he would go with Ta or not.
Yeah, Ta is an interesting character. You know, rest in peace for sure. I will mention he did appear in all three prequel trilogy movies, so there is a live action version of him. If you go on his Wikipedia page, he's on there as well.
I feel like I knew that, but I definitely didn't. I just did not put two and two together.
Curiously enough, again, he is in Lords of the Sith by Paul Kemp, which is interesting because that takes place 8 years after the events of the Bad Batch. So a little bit of a continuity thing there.
Unless he's not dead.
Dun, dun, dun. Wow, he was really good at faking death when they were carrying him off on a stretcher. I'm not a huge stickler for canon things. You know, I think as it's kind of the nature of the beast with Star Wars, as you're creating this tapestry of things, and you know, Lords of the Sith came out so long ago, so like naturally things could kind of change. Like, it's like the Kanan comic.
6 whole years.
Oof. Yeah.
I mean, were literal babies then.
But you know, things change. Canon might have to change here and there. It's okay. It's not you know.
Yeah.
All right. Well, Sarah, did you have any final thoughts on Devil's Deal before we close out?
My final thoughts are that this was an overall a good episode. I really appreciated seeing young Hera and Chopper, and I cannot wait to see what happens next. Also, the Omega moment in Hera was just precious as frickin' frack. So I'm looking forward to seeing how it all kind of comes to a conclusion in the next episode.
Yeah, no, I love this episode, even though it didn't feature our main Bad Batch characters as much as some might have liked, which I definitely understand. I think it's awesome to explore Hera's past a little more, especially when we have the opportunity to do so. I mean, what other time are we going to be able to do this? And might as well take that chance and might as well show us. And I think it's going to end up being something extremely important for the Bad Batch's journey, because again, everything matters. Like, everything's put there for a reason. It all matters in the end. It comes to a point, and I'm excited to see what that is next week with Rescue on Ryloth. So hopefully a high stakes episode, and I'm hoping Chopper rolls around on his one wheel and shoots some baddies. That would be fun.
Yeah.
I miss dual wheel Chopper.
100%. I would also like this, just to be very clear.
Yes. Well, until next week, Sarah, where can our listeners find you online?
You can find me on Twitter at SEH221 and on Instagram at Sarah's Puzzled Pages.
And as for me, you can find me on Twitter, and you can find the podcast on Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Make sure wherever you're listening to the show to leave us a 5-star written review if you'd be so kind. Helps other people find the show and join our Star Wars discussion. So lots of good things coming up on the podcast here shortly. And we're also going to be talking more about the High Republic in the coming weeks. So stay tuned for that.
We also have a Patreon where tiers start at just $1 a month. And we are so grateful for all of our Patreons. Adam, Amy, Anna, Brian with an I, Brian with a Y, Cheryl, Deborah, Donnie, Elegy, Jesse, Knights of Ren, Huang, Levi, Lindsay, Lucy, Marie Claire, Neil, Rachel, Sarah, Saber Bouquet, Sky Talkers, T, and Travis. Thank you so much for your support. We appreciate you a bunch.
Yes, thank you as always. And to everybody out there listening, thank you for sticking with us through this entire episode. Until next time, may the force be with you always.
Bye.